Okay, can you hear me? Yeah, I guess it's loud enough. So, thank you for coming to my talk about Gradle. When I handed in that talk, I named it Gradle 3.0 and beyond because it was 3.0 was closer to where I was or where Gradle was when at that time, and now it's 4.0 is quite close. So maybe the next bigger release is 4.0. So I took the liberty to rename it to Gradle Heading 4.0, which reflects more reality in my opinion. So yeah, quick note about myself, not much to say. My name is René. I'm working for Gradle now for 5 years, more or less exactly. I live in Berlin. Yeah, you can reach me using Twitter, GitHub or email if you have any questions regarding Gradle, regarding that talk, or yeah, want to chat, I don't know. What I'm going to talk about is mainly the latest features we worked on in Gradle Core. I will demo my favorite features. We don't have the time to feature or to show all of them. Then I talk about what we're currently working on, so what you can expect in the next upcoming weeks or months, let's say. I have some demos prepared. They should work, I guess. And then we have hopefully time for Q&A. And afterwards, as far as I understand, I'm in that corner somewhere and you can grab me to ask questions. And I brought stickers if you need to pimp your Mac or laptop or whatever you want to pimp. I'm not going to into detail about the introduction about Gradle. Maybe just as, who of you is using Gradle? Okay, the others are using Maven. Poor souls. Aren't? Okay. So I just give a management summary. So Gradle is a multi-purpose software automation tool. All buzzwords in that summary. You can use it to build, automate, and deliver your software better and faster. That's our tagline. It's written in Java, so it's not, as I notice, often people say it's written in Groovy. It's actually to 99% written in Java. So if that's a concern why you're not switching, it's really mainly in Java. It's cross-platform. In our CI infrastructure, we test against all major Java versions, IBM JDKs and all that stuff. It's language agnostic, so we started with Java support and Groovy support, but we now support also languages like C++ or we have some Groovy support in there, but yeah, we have a strong commitment to support native languages, so you can even compile assembler with Gradle if you want to. I had to write the test coverage for that stuff, so that was hard. It's Apache version 2 license, so you can use it for free without any obligations. And lately we added on top of that build tool, we added something we named cloud services. I will talk a little bit about that at the end. Yeah, but first, when I talk about releases, so I said we are now closer to 4.0 than we went to with 3.0. At the moment, we have about 30 people working, or 30 engineers working full-time on Gradle with 3.0 released in August 2016, so more than a half a year ago, I think. Latest major release was, or latest final release was 3.4.1 in the beginning of March, and last week we released release candidate 2 with 3.5, and I expect version 3.5 to be maybe the latest 3.0 release, or the last 3.0 release released somewhere next week. And then the next one might be 4.0. It depends on what our management decides, actually, because the 4.0 release will not have many more features than any other minor release. So the way we organize our releases is that we don't do big bang releases. The 4.0 is more about a statement that we think we reached a certain set of features we wanted to have complete after 3.0, and it more and it's more for us to cut deprecations and stuff there. And generally, we release something about 4 to 6 weeks. So let's take a closer look at my favorite latest features. So I'm in Russia, so I expect somebody knows what that island is. Good. Usually when I ask it, I was at JavaLand in Germany last week, nobody knows. So that island is named Kotlin, for those who don't know, and why I'm showing that island. So actually Gradle is, or the Gradle team is working together with the JetBrains guys to get a Kotlin-based Gradle DSL with Gradle Core. And why have we started that last year? So the motivation behind that support, besides having Groovy support for Gradle DSLs, was that the current DSL was there from the very beginning. Since 0.2, it hasn't much changed yet. Maybe added some stuff on top, but the fundamentals have been there since 7 years ago when Gradle was more or less founded. And it was not designed for two things. One was, it was not designed for performance, so we use a lot of that Groovy magic tricks with the dynamic features to look up methods who don't exist. And we did some AST transformation foo with the task declarations, which creates a nice DSL, but when I do a training and I explain how that things work, and usually I say, yeah, it's just Groovy, you just have, you can look it up in the API, people complain that we added too much magic there. And the other thing is that it's not very tooling friendly. One reason is that magic stuff we put on top, like this AST transformation. The other thing is that Groovy these days has really bad, on my opinion, quite bad IDE support, especially for Eclipse. Who's using Eclipse? Russia IntelliJ. Ah, okay, cool. Yeah, so you're blessed, kind of. And yeah, we work closely with the JetBrains guys here. And the idea is that currently when you design your Gradle build scripts, there's not much support in there, but the JetBrains guys added some stuff in the IDE. But what we would like to have is that you use the same pattern you use for your development, like, I couldn't code without having code completion and stuff like this. And look up the documentation and all the refactoring capabilities you have in your IDE. We want to have that in your build script too. So that's why we started supporting Kotlin, and we started to talk with the JetBrains guys on this. Who's using Kotlin, or who knows Kotlin? Okay, so, well, more than average Java conference, but it's a statically typed language. I just do a quick summary, it's not about Kotlin here. The 1.0 was released last year, and what we like about it is that it's driven by pragmatism, so JetBrains invented it actually to solve their own issues. As said, invented and maintained by JetBrains. And it has a considerable uptake in the, especially in the Android world. So the nice thing is it brings some features like Lambdas back on Java 1.6, which was or is still necessary for Android development. So that's why it has some momentum. And since it's coming from JetBrains, it has first-class IDE support. So that's one of the few languages which start showing up, and you have immediately awesome language or IDE support. So that's what we are looking forward to, and it will allow you to create the build DSL with ease and make it easier to apply your usual developer patterns like refactoring and stuff what I just mentioned. The current state is that we're still working closely with JetBrains. We release with Gradle 3.0, we will support Kotlin 1.1.0, or I think there's even a minor release now there. And the feature, what we call Gradle Script Kotlin, is in version 0.8. It will be in Gradle 3.5, and will be quite close to. Will already have full support for design your build scripts in Kotlin. I have a quick sample here how it will look like. It looks quite similar to what you know from the Groovy DSL. It's a bit more explicit here, like you use method calls at some point, but this stuff looks more or less exactly the same like what you know from the Groovy DSL. Yeah. Okay, let's put Kotlin aside. Quick question in between. Whose build is too fast? None, right? So, yeah, I'm doing build tools now for 5 years and I never heard somebody saying, hey, my build is too fast. Usually people come and complain. Gradle is too slow. Every build tool is too slow, but yeah, I just care if Gradle is too slow. So, we consider performance as a feature, and what I mean by that is that the way your build works or the way the performance of your build is has a high impact on how you use your build tool or your tooling in general. Let's assume your quick dev commit or pre-commit build takes, I don't know, half an hour. Who of you would do that? Or well, you can do that and grab a coffee and another one and maybe another one. But what you want to have is a quick feedback loop, right? You want to change something in your code. You want to run your tests or your build and see the results as fast as possible. So a build tool and Gradle can't be fast enough. So we formed a dedicated performance team that focuses on performance-related features and issues. What we currently, so the three items I've listed here is what we currently have on our to-do list. So one is driven by the Android developer experience. So Android is a specific topic because they use these, they have their own plugin, they have their whole own community, and it's in Android development tools and so on. So there's much work we can do on the Gradle side to make things faster, and in cooperation with the Android guys to help them make their plugin faster using newer features we added to Gradle Core to make the plugin experience or the developer experience better. Another thing is dependency resolution. So usually your build has dependencies. It depends a bit on how big your projects are, but we have clients like Netflix or LinkedIn. They have something like 5,000 modules in their build. And every time they resolve their artifacts, it's a considerable time lost and waiting. So we're currently working there on making that, resolving things in parallel, improving the way it's resolved by solving some shortcomings in our implementation. And last but not least, but maybe the biggest pain point for some of the users, especially if they have big builds, big complex builds, is a configuration time. So every time you invoke Gradle, you have that, you pay the price of the configuration time where all your builds or sub-projects are configured. And you suffer from that even if you just call Gradle help. So that's something we want to reduce. Hans, our CEO, I think at last Gradle Summit, our own conference, he had a slide there where there was a statement like configuration time zero. All our developers just looked at it and, oh shit, how to do that? But we want to get at least close to that, right? Here are some numbers from what we currently achieved with the Google team. So AGP means Android Gradle plugin. So that's a combination here of Android Gradle plugin and the Gradle version. So that's where we started our effort here to making things faster. So we started with the configuration time on a sample project. I can share that project so you can. It's open source, so you can check these numbers yourself. So we started with configuration time of like 2 minutes, and yeah, people were complaining quite a lot. So, and if we have two scenarios here, one is configuration time, and one is a typical developer use case of changing one line in Java. And actually, we went down from 2 minutes and 15 seconds to something around 6.4 seconds. So these numbers I've took them from the Android team. They just put these numbers on their website. So that's what we're currently working on. Who's using Android or doing Android stuff with Gradle? Have you tried the Android Gradle plugin 2.5 yet? It's a nightly version or alpha version, but yeah, you should give it a try and maybe report feedback or any issues you see. So that's about performance. I come back to performance again later. Composite builds. So who of you has ever tried or needed to include an external project in their IDE, maybe for debugging purposes, maybe for hot fixes or stuff? We've seen that at some clients that they moved separate projects with different life cycles actually, which you would consider that should live in a single repository. They moved everything in a monorepo kind of structure and built it from there. That's kind of a thing now, driven by Google was a team that make that approach big, who's doing kind of this. Yeah, and do you like it, or is it just because you need to make it work kind of, because it's painful otherwise? Yeah. And the other, or the third thing, where composite builds, which I'm showing soonish, will help you, is when you want to test your Gradle plugin. So who of you wrote a Gradle plugin before? Maybe just an internal one? So many people using Gradle, but not so many writing plugins. We did something wrong. So it's really easy, right? So it's not like a Maven plugin. It's really easy. So for the use cases I just described, you can use a feature what we call composite builds. Composite build means you can join two different builds together to build at once and rely on the sources of each other. So you can do that either by declaring include another build from the command line, or include a build, or patch up a build from different repositories or locations using a settings.gradle file. So you can declare several lists of external projects you want to include. And there's hopefully where my demo plays well. So that's a compiler wire and stuff. Can you see my screen? Maybe a bit bigger, right? So what I have here actually is really just the simplest library you can think of. So I generate the idea workspace. So I just have a library class. It doesn't matter what its purpose is. I just did it for demo reasons. And what I have here is, maybe we list the plugin itself or the Gradle build. So what I see is I have a set of dependencies, and one of it is commons-lang. Commons-lang. I don't know. I rarely see a project who does not use something like commons-lang or Guava. So, and what I do here is I generated the workspace. So there in my code, I use a tool or util class named random string utils, which comes from that library. And what I can see here, it's resolved from the binary, right? Now, if I want to test something, how can I do that? So what I did is I cloned that library into my workspace somewhere, commons-lang. And what I do now is I reference that build. And what I can see is that Gradle starts what it calls a composite build, and it includes this commons-lang project as a module here. And when I go back, now I see that project here showing up, and now in my library, if I go there, it's not the binary anymore, it's resolved by source. So you can easily join your builds together in your IDE or even on your CI server if you want to bring different teams together or make first class testing on CI server against early versions of your other teams' binaries or sources. Yeah. What else? Coming back to performance, so the fastest build is the one who does less, right? So the less Gradle does, the faster it can be. And one significant part of a build time, apart from maybe running your test, hopefully that's a significant time in your build, is compiling. And we worked hard on making this kind of stuff fast. So far, so if you have used Gradle, you know about the today checks. The microphone is not too well. Okay, so you know these up-to-date checks where if a task is running again in Gradle and the inputs haven't changed and the outputs haven't changed, Gradle marks this task as up-to-date. So it avoids doing stuff, and that's what makes Gradle fast. So Gradle can do better, especially when it comes to compiling. So what Gradle does now with the late, I think it's since 3.4 Gradle, or Gradle 3.4, it now detects binary intercompatibility changes in your code, and that allows you to reduce the number of the compile steps in your code. Let me demo that for you, what I meant by that. So I have a simple multi-project build here. I can demo that. So here you can see app core utils. And if I want to build, let's just invoke the app compile. So I want to compile the application. What I see is a dependency between core, utils, and app. So if I want to compile app relies on core and utils, so both needs to be compiled first. So far, nothing new, I guess. So I did that before, so everything is up to date. But now, that's small, I guess, but so this is just a demo app that does barely anything. But what I have here is in my core, I have a class person. That's the wrong one, of course. Better. And there's a typo there. So in my core dependency, on my core subproject, I now change the implementation of the class. Usually, would I need to recompile? Usually, Gradle needs to recompile. And why? Or do I need to recompile app? Usually, I would say yes, because Since the core jar changes, because I just fixed something in the code, the class path changes. And the class path is an input to the compile task, so input changes, the compile task needs to run again. But when I do that now, I see that for some reason, we run that compile Java task of that core project again, or it executed again because I changed it. That's what I expected. But app compile does not need to recompile. And why is that? The reason is that the binary interface of my class hasn't changed. So the interface exposed to my dependent project hasn't changed, so recompilation is not necessary. You might still need to run the test, but you don't need to recompile. What I mean by that, or maybe to make that clearer, if I change a public method or even remove one in the same class, I see that, okay, core needs to be compiled again, but now the binary interface has changed. So that all the dependent projects need to recompile. With three projects, there's not much time you save here, but if you have more than 50 or even beyond 100 multi-project build, that has a huge effect on your build time, as it sums up over time. Some more about Java goodness. So we work more on a Java incremental compiler. We want to make the incremental compiler the default. We worked on something we call a Java library plugin, and that will provide a way to have less class path leakage. So, and we claim that it creates better POMs than Maven. So the problem, yeah, we can discuss it in detail, what's wrong with Maven POMs, so much things. But in general, the compile and the runtime class path in POM files is not correct. Because in a Maven build, you usually, or in a POM file, you usually have that as describing the compile dependency of that library itself, of that POM, but also declaring it as a dependency once you use it as a library. So you resolve that library, you look into that POM, and you resolve all the dependencies listed as compile, which is wrong, because that's not what it's meant to be, but there's no other way in Maven to do that. In Gradle, we solve that now with a Java library plugin. There's more stuff about up-to-date checks. I'm running a bit out of time, but I can share that with you. So far I talked about that up-to-date check, so that Gradle uses artifacts from the last time it was invoked, running the exact same build on the exact same machine. It will mark things as up-to-date if nothing has changed. But again, we think Gradle can do better, so what we're currently working on is, why not reusing results from any time before any build we have run, from any machine we used. So we call that build cache, so that is something we're currently working hard on. And there are two different implementations of a build cache. One is a local one, which is similar to what you have now with a Gradle, or quite similar to what you have currently with a Gradle up-to-date mechanism, just reusing stuff from builds you run maybe days ago or something. But we also implement something we call distributed build cache. So you can configure a cache, maybe HTTP backend or whatever you would like to implement within your organization. And the benefit is there that we think that, let's say you have a team with 50 guys, maybe 200. Maybe you don't care, but your boss should care, that if you come in the morning, you check out the codes, all your 200 developers, and you build the exact same artifacts 200 times, even though your CI server at night already did that. So, and we have teams, we have seen teams which took like half an hour to build that stuff. So we're currently, we want to make that better. And what we have there is that distributed build cache. So the idea is you have a central place where maybe everybody is pushing to, but in this example here, for I just say, okay, I have my CI server building that stuff at night, pushing to a central place, and my developers can reuse artifacts if they match the inputs and outputs of my current build. And that time, that way, we want to save even more time and avoid building things again and again. I have 2 more minutes. I give them myself. I mentioned that we introduced something called cloud service. So what we did in the past, so I did consulting for CI infrastructure, comparing builds, discussing Gradle stuff with different teams. And what we noticed is that it's hard to talk about and compare stuff among an organization. And usually that's what you see. People are complaining, swearing. That's kind of our logo because we saw that a lot. But wouldn't it be nice if you can have a better way to collaborate on your builds and share or debug stuff together or optimize build performance? I know that it's hard and Gradle, yeah, we're working on that, but it can be hard to figure out what is a hotspot in your build and why does it take so long and how to get there. So we want to provide some help in that respect. And also, sometimes you see that maybe your colleague has a build which is really fast and your one is really slow. Maybe you just need an argument for a better machine. Maybe it's something with a network wrong there. So we want to have an easy way to compare different builds. And also another use case, even especially if you are a bigger company with a dedicated build team. What I saw in the past is there are teams with sometimes 5 people dedicated to build teams, which write Gradle scripts or other kind of scripts, but they have no clue how the developers use their build, or maybe they use it wrong or not as they expected it. So we want to have a way that the CI team, for example, can discover how their build scripts are used among the whole organization. So that's where we introduce what we call Gradle build scans. I'm running a bit out of time, but you can actually grab me afterwards and I can show you a demo, or you can try it yourself. So there are open source projects who are using it. If you want to try it yourself, just give it a run. It's free to test or to try out on our cloud on Gradle.com. There's plenty of more stuff we are working on, but I just put it there for completeness. I'm happy to talk about all this stuff afterwards. And if you have any questions, yeah, you just now is the time.
Hello, René. Thank you for your speech. I hope you enjoy Novosibirsk Spring. Question is, you are implementing support of Kotlin. Cool. But maybe I haven't heard it. What's your intention about Groovy? Will you continue support Groovy, or you are going to drop Groovy as a language for build scripts in the nearest future?
At the moment, there's no plan. There are no plans to drop Groovy, so we can't actually afford that because all our scripts at the moment are Groovy, and we invested a lot in the Groovy stuff, but we saw people suffering from their weak IDE support, and it's not getting better. So that's why we introduced Kotlin as a second step. But we don't plan to drop Groovy anytime soon. So not in the next, I don't know. We haven't even bring Kotlin into 1.0 state. So we don't know where it's going. We hopefully, the Kotlin thing is going well and picking up steam, but we can't make any statements about that.
Thank you. You make me calmer.
Hello, thank you for your speech. You mentioned that, and I know that Groovy can be used to build stuff other than based on Java technology stack. How much emphasis there is in development team on bringing in new features for other languages and stacks?
There are two things we are currently working on in terms of supporting other languages. One is obviously making Kotlin work better and better with Gradle, with supporting Kotlin projects and stuff. And the other one, or maybe three, the other one is that we have a dedicated guy focusing on making native builds better, so C, C++, that kind of stuff. And that's basically what we're currently focusing on in terms of language support.
So the new features like detecting API changes and stuff, do they apply to something else like Java?
The API changes, that's specific to the Java compiler. Because it's very Java specific. I guess it's working. I don't know if it's working for the Groovy compiler, but I guess not.
Okay, thanks.